Okay, so chapter 17, you've got carboxylic acids and esters in amides. I know that looks like amides, but in chemistry, we say amides. Sorry about that. And then there's going to be another type, a functional group that's spelled A-M-I-N-E. And those are amines instead of amines. So I'm going to pass around to you guys some carboxylic acids. So the three that are together are acetic acid, butyric acid, and butyric acid. So acetic acid, this is what we put in water to make a solution and make vinegar. So that's in here. And then butyric acid, that smells like Parmesan cheese or vomit. And then caprylic acid, also called hexanoic acid, because it has six carbons, smells like stinky socks, or when I was looking it up on Wikipedia, it says dirty goats. I have no idea what a dirty goat smells like, but that's what it says, okay? So the first three, they're pretty smelly. They're not super strong like when we did the thiols and it filled up the whole room. And then the second two are esters. And that's another functional group we're going to talk about. And esters tend to smell really nice. So we have banana oil, and then we have oil of wintergreen, and we're going to make those tomorrow in lab along with some soap so you guys can smell them, and you'll smell them again tomorrow. So there you go. Pass those around. So carboxylic acids. We've seen these before. And how we got to carboxylic acids was we took a primary alcohol, and then we oxidized it, and it went through the aldehyde, and it went to the carboxylic acid. Do you guys remember that concept, maybe? Okay. So a carboxylic acid, instead of having a hydrogen right there like the aldehydes do, or another R group right there like ketones do, carboxylic acids will have an OH group. And there's a few ways that you guys will see them. You'll see them written out like this to where you can see everything, or you'll see the abbreviated version where it says CO2H, and that does not mean that the oxygens are bonded to each other. That's just a simpler way of drawing this. And the other way that you guys will see it is where the CO2H is written with both of the oxygens like that. So it'll say COOH. So that's all the versions of the carboxylic acid that you guys should come across, okay? Any questions on that? No? We're good? Okay. All right, so those are the ones you guys are sniffing here. So notice acetic acid has two carbons, and butyric acid, that B-U-T part in the front should tell you you have how many carbons in that molecule?
Four.
And then caprylic acid doesn't really give you any hints, but can you guys see how many carbons you have there? So yeah, you have six. So that's also called hexanoic acid, and the hex is telling you that you've got six there. Okay, so where in real life do we encounter carboxylic acids? Well, all over the place. So you guys are sniffing three of them as they come around. Another one that our bodies use all the time is folic acid. And folic acid is made by the liver. And you guys can see that it has four rings here. And we've got the A, B, C, and D rings. And that should tell you when you have A, B, C, and D, and three of them, the A, B, and the C, are six carbon rings, and the D is a five carbon ring, that you have a steroid backbone right there, okay? So our other steroids, like testosterone, will look like this. Also, cholesterol will look like this. Folic acid is made from cholesterol. And the polar regions, like the carboxylic acid region on folic acid, those things are attracted to hydrophilic molecules, like water in your body. And hydrophobic sections, the hydrocarbon in here, those are going to be attracted to nonpolar things like fats. So folic acid helps to put fats what do you notice about that fatty acid up at the top, palmitic acid? What functional group is on there, you guys?
We use that the glycerol plus the three fatty acids make what?
A triglyceride. So this thing right here is the triglyceride.
The entire
so glycerol plus our three fatty acids, those get together and they make a triglyceride. So palmitic acid up here is just a fatty acid by itself. So what do you guys notice about palmitic acid? Which functional group is on it?
Carboxylic acid.
A carboxylic acid. So fatty acids are carboxylic acids that have these really long R tails, okay? So the carboxylic acid site on that, and that R is really long. Now, they don't tend to be soluble in water because those R chains are super long. So they do have that tiny little polar end, but when you have this giganto thing that's nonpolar, you're gonna be pretty much nonpolar and not dissolved in water. Is that making sense to us, you guys? Kind of, sort of, maybe? You guys look like you're super excited today. Okay. So palmitic acid is the most common saturated fatty acid that's found in animals, plants, and microorganisms. And if we're also looking at this triglyceride down here, you might notice that this one right here has a cis double bond, and this one right here has three cis double bonds. And we notice that over here we have the alpha carbon. And remember last time when we were naming things, we said in common nomenclature, the alpha carbon is not the carbonyl carbon, it's the one next to it. Do you guys remember that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay, so we would go alpha, beta, gamma, blah, 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 all the way to the end over here where we have the omega end. And omega is kind of cool because when you draw it, it looks like a little butt. So you're like, ha, 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 if you have like a 12-year-old sense of humor like me. So right here, here's the omega end, and you go one, two, three carbons in before you hit the first double bond. So this is an omega-3 fatty acid. Does that make sense, you guys? So you've heard about the omega-3s and the omega-6, and yeah, most of us have at least heard of it. If we're like, I've heard of it, but I'm not really sure what those do, but yeah, one's good, and something comes from fish, and we've kind of heard all of this stuff, right, you guys? Okay, so that's what it means. It means that the omega-3 means that if you heal from the end, your first double bond is going to appear at the third one from the end. Any questions for me, you guys? Okay, so mammals have a limited ability to synthesize omega-3 fatty acids. They're important for us for brain development, so we have to get them from our diet. So sometimes what you guys will see is like on baby formula, you'll see DHA and ALA, things like that listed on there that it's added to it. So it's saying that it's adding these important omega-3 fatty acids that the baby needs for brain development that's really hard to get from our diet. Questions on that, you guys? We're good? Okay. All right. So where else we will see carboxylic acids? That's in analgesics. And analgesics do what? Did anyone not get to smell these? Everyone's? Okay. I'll just leave them up here just in case you were shy. Didn't want to admit that you hadn't smelled them yet. All right, so analgesics, what are those, you guys? I heard wee, 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 wee from out there. Be bold, say it. Well, aspirin, ibuprofen, and naproxen. That might give you a hint there, guys.
Pain relievers.
Yes, thank you. They're pain relievers, and you guys can see their carboxylic acid functional groups on there right there. Okay. So what they do is they mess with the production of prostaglandins. And prostaglandins are released in our body muscle, especially in the uterus, so during birth, to have contractions or during that time of month when you get cramps, okay? It also causes constriction in the lungs, in the muscles in there, bronchoconstriction, and in the eyeballs. So if you take something that's going to block that prostaglandin, it's going to release, it's going to relieve you from the pain and inflammation that's caused by those different muscles contracting. And it's like, ah, relief. So that's what's going on there. Any questions about that, you guys? No? You guys are just full of questions today, aren't you? Okay, so we talked a little bit about carboxylic acid. So now you guys know that we have to come to naming them, right? We always have to do that. And then what do we do after that?
Reactions.
And then we go on to something else. And we talk about the kind of interesting things about it. And we sniff them. And then we talk about how to name them, common and IUCA, and then their reactions. And then we go on to the next one. And then we get to do labs on these things after we talk about them. Okay, so common nomenclature, you guys. So it says change the YL of the group to OYL of the acyl group, or the OYL of the acyl group to IC acid. So when you have a carbonyl, got two carbons right there, that's an acetyl group. So if we have an OH on the end, it's going to be acetic acid. And this is common nomenclature, you guys. Okay, so remember that. So that's going to appear right here. So it's saying that the acyl group is this one right here, acetyl. And right here, if you have two carbons and you have the OH on the end, that becomes so it changes from acetyl to acetic acid. Now, if you only have one carbon, so your formal group would look like this. And then we have a bond there. And that little squiggly right there means that something's on the other side of it. Okay? So this right here is the formal group. Now, if we put a hydrogen on the other side of that, like that, then we have formic acid. And formic acid is also drawn like that. Okay? So your acetyl group is right here. And if you put an OH on it, it becomes acetic acid. And the other way that we can draw that is right there. Now, when you have three carbons, you become propionic acid, and so the prop part of it should tell you you have how many carbons, you guys?
Three.
And then the next one is butyric, and the B-U-T part of it should tell you you have how many carbons?
Four.
Are we okay with that, you guys? Kind of, sort of, maybe? And if you didn't like what I drew, there it is down there, okay? Now, if you guys remember, if we had an H there, that would be formaldehyde. You guys kind of sort of remember that? Okay. If we had two carbons and we had an H there, that was acetaldehyde. And you guys saw that yesterday in lab. Yes, no, maybe so? What about if we had three carbons? So we had CH3 carbon here and then CH3 on that side. That was, if we have three carbons and the middle one is a carbonyl group like that, what kind of functional group is that?
Ketone.
That's a ketone, okay? And so that would be acetone. So we have acetic acid or acetic aldehyde, acetone. So you guys see how it's staying consistent? Okay, good, good. And then benzoic acid is on the end over there, and you guys can see it's got a benzene ring. And we can't put the carboxylic acid functional group part of it on the ring, so like with the aldehyde, we have to hang it off of the side. So that one over there is benzoic acid. Okie dokie, Smokies? Okay, all right. So when it gets a little more complicated in common nomenclature, meaning you have other groups hanging off carboxylic acid, so it says ick acid on the end. And then we have a bromine hanging off of it. And we said that in common nomenclature, when we identify which carbon that our branch is hanging off of, we don't start the carbonyl carbon as alpha. The one next to it is the alpha. So this is alpha bromobutyric acid. You guys are right with that? Okay. So the next one that has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons is valeric acid. So it would kind of make sense if there was a pent in there somewhere, but the common name for a carboxylic acid with 5 carbons is valeric acid. And we have a chlorine hanging off of it, so we go alpha, beta, gamma, and then the next one is a delta. So you guys can see that we've got beta chlorovaleric acid. Okie dokie smokies. Super exciting. Okay, so when you have a ring, what do you do with the ring? Well, you just say the ring's name. There's a cyclohexane and it's got a carboxylic acid hanging off of it. So cyclohexane, carboxylic acid. Not too bad, right? Okay. And what about when you have dicarboxylic acids? Well, those have weird common names that you guys do not need to memorize, but just know that they exist. Okay? Lots of answers. Yay! Okay. So, you guys actually have heard of carboxylic acids that have an OH on the alpha carbon. So, this right here is the alpha carbon. You guys can see that we got an OH hanging off of those. And we call those alpha hydroxy acids. And the hydroxy portion of it, that's telling you that there is what on the alpha carbon? I circled it. Someone said, yeah, the OH. Remember when you have a functional group on your hydrocarbon chain that's taking priority over the alcohol, the OH? The alcohol doesn't get the ending, the OL, it becomes a branch, and when it goes to a branch, it changes its name to hydroxy. Do you guys remember that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. All right, so these are alpha hydroxy acids, and we use these in chemical peels for our face. So it takes off the first layer of skin, and we use it for wrinkles and acne and stuff like that. Like, you might have heard of a glycolic acid peel. Yes, no, maybe so. Okay, so that's where we use these guys, our alpha hydroxy acids. Questions for me? No? Okay, so let's do a problem. Pumelic acid, 7H12O4, this is a dicarboxylic acid, and it's involved in the biosynthesis of the amino acid lysine, and we want to draw this molecule in line bond form. So what do we do first? Draw a little caterpillar with how many carbons, you guys?
Seven.
So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And we'll get rid of that line that came in from who knows where. Why did you do that? Okay. All right. So, and then you count them again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Just make sure you have 7. Now, it's a dicarboxylic acid. Our carboxylic acid functional groups appear where in the molecule?
The end.
At the ends. Okay, so if you need to draw in the carbons on the end, and what we need to put on those carbons to make it a carboxylic acid functional group is what?
O double bond and OH.
Okay, so double bond and an OH. Yes, no, maybe so. Okay, and a double bond and an OH. And we probably would have preferred to draw the double bond O up because that's how we always see it, but that's how we drew the line bond structure. So we'll go with it, okay? Now, what you guys want to do is add up your carbons and your oxygens and your hydrogens to make sure you have the correct number. So we already know that we drew 7 carbons. Did we draw 4 oxygens, you guys?
Yes.
Do we have 12 hydrogens?
Yes.
two, four, six, eight, 10, and then 12. You guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
So each one of these points, there's a CH2 in there. Does anyone need to draw in all of the hydrogens? If you do, don't worry, I can do that. You pay me for that service. It's okay. Okay. All right. So now we have a UPAC nomenclature. And a UPAC nomenclature is going to be like the nomenclature for the other functional groups. It's going to follow the same path. So what we want to do is we want to replace the E on the end of the alkane name. Like if it's propane, you chop off the E and we add oic acid. So with common nomenclature, we added ic acid, but at UPAC, we're going to add oic acid. And the carbonyl carbon is carbon number one. So with common nomenclature, the carbonyl carbon didn't have an identity. It was just the carbonyl carbon. And the carbon next to it was the alpha carbon. Okay, but in IUPAC, IUPAC says that carbon has an identity. It's carbon number one. So with propanoic acid, that would be carbon one, two, and three. Is everybody okay with that? Yes, no, maybe so? Okay, so notice that you didn't have to say one propanoic acid or propan-1-oic acid. We know that the carboxylic acid functional group is going to be on the end over there. So over to the next example, we have three methyl pentanoic acids. So without even looking at the structure, the pentan part of it should tell you that there's how many carbons?
Five.
There's going to be five carbons in the parent chain that includes the carboxylic acid functional group, okay? There might be some other carbons hanging off the parent chain, but there's five carbons in the parent chain, okay? So one, two, three, four, five. And we numbered backwards because we wanted the carbon of the carboxylic acid functional group to have the lowest number possible because that's one of IUPAC's rules. So if we were just at, okay, we've got a five carbon chain, should we number forwards or backwards? That's why we would choose to number backwards. And then this branch right here is a methyl and it's hanging off of carbon number three. So we've got three methyl pentanoic acid. And again, we chopped the E off of pentane and we added oic acid. Okie dokie smokies, not too bad. Can we see the rules over and over and over again? Okay, good. So what happens if we have multiple carboxylic acid groups? Well, we have to use the Greek prefixes, di, tri, tetra, and also the E comes back in on the parent chain. So instead of octanoic acid, we'd have octane, where the E is back in there, dioic acid. You guys all right with that? Okay. So looking at the end one over there, we've got two carboxylic acid functional groups. So we've got three ethyl, six methyl, octane, dioic acid. And we didn't put the numbers in there because we assumed that the carboxylic acid functional groups were on the end. And if you have a six carbon chain, one of them's going to be on one and the other one's going to be on eight. Okie dokie, smokies? Okay, any questions on that one, you guys? Okay, now, is there any question as to why ethyl got to be number three and methyl was number six?
Because ethyl alphabetical order?
Yes. So if you look at this, you guys, we could have either way, there's going to be a carboxylic acid functional group on 1 and 8, or 1 and 8. Now we could do 1, 2, 3, and 6, so 3 ethyl and 6 methyl, or we could have 1, 2, 3 methyl and 6 ethyl. So it would be 3, 6 either way. You guys see that? And then IUPAC says if you have something like that where it could be 3, 6 either way, ethyl comes before methyl in the alphabet, so you go ahead and give ethyl the lower number. Okay? All right, good. we have cyclohexane carboxylic acid. And don't worry about whether the hydrogen is pointing out at you or behind the board, and the same thing for the carboxylic acid right there at this point. Okay, so is everybody okay with cyclohexane carboxylic acid for that name, you guys? Okay. Now, there's something else on the ring, so we have to identify where it's at. And since the carbon that's bonded to the carboxylic acid functional group gets carbon number one, we can do 1 and 4, or 1 and 4 is going to be OH bonded to carbon number 4. Either way, we number around the ring. So are we okay with why OH is on carbon 4? We're good with that, you guys? Okay. So OH, when it's a branch, it changes its name to hydroxy. We just talked about that. You guys remember that? So when it's the functional group with higher priority, it gets the ending, and you would see the OL on the end. But the carboxylic acid, right here, you guys, has higher priority than the alcohol, so it gets the ending there. So instead of having OL on the end, this is a branch, and it changes its name to hydroxy. Now, this trans up here, if you have this ring, what it's saying is that if the OH is pointing up on the top of the ring, then the CO2H will be pointing on the bottom of the ring, or the other way around. If the OH was on the bottom side of the ring, then the CO2 would be up here on the top of the ring. And I'd have to build you guys a model to show you that a little bit better if I expected you guys to be able to do something like that. But I won't give you that cis and trans thing with the rings. Where you guys will see cis and trans is with double bonds, okay, with cis and trans isomers, okay? So I would draw these just with flat lines, and then you guys would put 4-hydroxycyclohexane carboxylic acid. Okie dokie, smokies? Okay. So then we have that ring over there, and if we didn't have the double bond, what we would have is a cyclopentane. But since there is a double bond, that would be a cyclopentene at that point. Are you guys okay with that? Cyclopentene? All right, now the carboxylic acid functional group that has priority over the double bond, but the double and triple bond things, they still kind of appear towards the end of the name. They don't go to the front like the alcohol did and change their name. So what you'll see here is cyclopentene. So you see that there's that double bond right there. And then we throw carboxylic acid on the end like we did over there. Okay. Now this carbon right here, because it's a ring, this is number one because it's bonded to the carbon of the carboxylic acid functional group, just like the rule said. We okay with that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Now the one is right there telling you that the double one starts at carbon one. Question.
So if we move the carboxyl group over to like 3, or the carboxylic acid to 3, would you be giving 3 the one, or?
Yes.
Okay.
So the question was, if we move CO2H to this position right here, then this carbon right here that the CO2H was bonded to, that would become carbon 1. And that would mean that the double bond was starting on carbon number 2, because you'd go up this way. So it would be 2-cyclopentene carboxylic acid. So just in case you didn't catch that, the question was, what would happen if we moved the carboxylic acid functional group down there? And we said that we would number it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 like that. So then we would have 2-cyclopentene carboxylic acid. Okay, does that make sense? And again, you guys, carboxylic acid, that functional group, has higher priority than aldehyde or ketone, and higher priority than an alcohol or a thiol. Questions for me? Do you guys remember what happens when an aldehyde or a ketone is not the higher priority? When it becomes a branch, it changes from the al ending or the own ending to what name when it's up front? And they're both the same. That was formaldehyde. So this name is going to start with form in common nomenclature. And it's going to have an ending of what, since it's a carboxylic acid functional group over there?
Oic acid?
Not oic acid. That is IUPAC. It's a little shorter than that for common.
Acid.
Formic acid. We end it with ic acid for common nomenclature. Does that sound familiar, you guys? Okay. So this one is formic acid. Another one that we did like this one with common nomenclature that we said it would be really nice if there was like pent in there somewhere, but there wasn't. Does anyone remember that? Okay, so that was way back here. Right here, valeric acid. Okay, so that one right there is beta chlorovaleric acid. And what is this one here? So since it's 5, we know it's valeric acid. And then we have alpha, beta, gamma, and this guy's our delta. So tell me the rest of the name. What goes on the front there, you guys? Yeah, so we have alpha, chlorovaleric acid. So looking at that one, alpha chlorovaleric acid, and going back to the one that we did before, we had beta chlorovaleric acid.
On the test, would you be giving us like alpha, beta, gamma if we needed that? Like, would you mark the carbons alpha, beta, gamma?
You should know that one. I would give you valeric acid because that isn't one that is super common to memorize. Okay, using our UPAC nomenclature, you guys. Anyone want to take a stab at the first one and number two? How many carbons in the parent chain, you guys?
Five.
So one, two, three, four, five. Yes, no, maybe so. Number forwards or backwards?
Backwards.
Backwards, because a UPAC says this carboxylic acid functional group right here, it has priority, and you want to give it the lowest number possible, so we want the number one to be on the carbonyl carbon. So we have one, two, three, four, five. And again, remember, you guys, in IUPAC, number one starts on the carbonyl carbon, but with common nomenclature, you don't put anything there, the next one over is your alpha carbon. Weird, but that's how it is. Okay, you guys, so what are we going to say first for the name on this one? It's a number. Somebody, say some number.
Four, bromo.
Four, yes. Four what? I heard it.
Bromo.
Bromo. Is everybody okay with we started out with four bromo? Okay, and it's got five carbons. So we're going to take pentane and chop the E off the end and put what? Yes, oic acid. Okay, so we chopped the end off of pentane and we added oic acid. So for a UPAC, the ending is oic acid, and for common nomenclature, it's ic acid. Okie dokie, smokies. Okay, the next one over there, how many carbons in the longest carbon chain that includes the carboxylic acid functional group?
Six.
And are we going to number backwards?
Yes.
Yes, okay. So one, two, three, four, five, six. Okay, you guys. Start me out with some numbers.
Three, four.
Not three, four.
Three.
Yes, three, comma, three. There's two branches on carbon number three. So we have to locate both of those branches and say what they are, but not until we do two more numbers, which
four,
are what and what?
Four.
Four. out the end and add oic space acid. Are we okay with that? Not too bad on the IUPAC stuff, you guys? Okay. And again, we don't have to put one hexanoic acid or hexan one oic acid because the carboxylic acid functional group is going to be where?
The end.
On the end, on one. Okay. And if we have two of them and we have a hydrocarbon chain that's just in between, then it's kind of obvious where they are. So that's why on this one right here, we didn't have the 1 and the 8, okay? Because they're on the ends, and so they're going to be 1 and 8. Okay, so let's draw 1, 2, 4 benzene tricarboxylic acid. So what part of the name do you see right away that you can just draw and start with? So you get to start carbon number 1 wherever you want to start carbon number 1, and most of us start where?
Top.
At the top, okay? So it says 1, 2, 4 benzene. I already drew my benzene. Now I have tri, so there's 3 of them, carboxylic acid. So what am I going to draw on the top there, you guys?
Double bond O.
I'm going to draw a C and then what?
O2H.
O2H, okay. So O2H like that, does that work? Yes, now maybe so, you guys? Okay, and then I want another carboxylic acid functional group on carbon number 2. So can I go either left or right?
Yes.
Yeah, it doesn't matter at this point. And we can draw our carboxylic acid functional group, that's a C, you guys, in a different way, but it's saying the same thing. Now I've got one on carbon 4, so where is that? On the bottom. So then I'll draw it even a different way, COOH. Are we okay with all those 3 different ways of drawing the carboxylic acid functional group or saying the same thing? Okay. Questions for me, you guys? Concerns? Complaints? Deep sighs? Don't worry, next week is the beast. This week, we had a day off. Next week, you guys are going to be like, oh, let it end. It's always like that before. Okay, so structure and physical properties of our carboxylic acid. So, this right here, that's your carbonyl carbon. That means that the oxygen that's connected to the carbonyl carbon is which oxygen? Oh, come on, you guys. I circled it and I pointed to it. The carbonyl oxygen. But we have another oxygen in there. And that one has a special name, too. And the oxygen that's not the carbonyl oxygen is the carboxylate oxygen right there. Okay? So just in case I'm using that lingo, the carbonyl oxygen or the carboxylate oxygen, that's what I'm talking about. I'll usually say the oxygen of the OH over here, just because I know you guys have a million terms in your head right now that you're trying to keep straight. So anyways, there's the terminology. Now the carbonyl carbon, around it, we're going to have 3 things bonded. You guys can see that. And so we're going to have what kind of geometry? Trigonal planar. And when we took 2A and we talked about trigonal planar, we had 120, 120, and 120. But the thing about that is it's approximate. And it's going to depend on what your groups are around that central atom, because different groups will take up a different amount of space. And so the bonds will have to flex a little bit. So you guys can see here how that one opens up to 127 up there. These hydrogens on this carbon, they take up a lot of space, and then you've got the lone pairs on that oxygen wanting to do the same thing, and so that bends this down a little bit to 111. But don't worry about that, you guys. The basic geometry is trigonal planar, and all 3 angles are about 120, give or take. Okay?
We're all right with that? Yes, Naomi, you so?
Yes.
Okay. Now, physical properties. Notice the boiling points. So when we look at acetic acid, which is a carboxylic acid, versus isopropyl alcohol, versus acetone, versus isobutylene, right? They're all structures that are pretty similar. What we notice about the boiling point of our carboxylic acid is that it's what? It's very high. And when you have a high boiling point compared to other molecules of the same size, what that means is your molecules have something that's making them interact more. And usually what we're talking about is what? Hydrogen bonds, okay? So when we were talking about alcohols and ethers and aldehydes and ketones, we took a look at the different boiling points. And when you had hydrogen bonding going on, you tend to stick your molecules together a lot more, and that meant you had to put in more heat to get them apart. You have to get your molecules apart in order to get them to go from liquid to gas, which is the definition of what?
Boiling.
Okay? Now, carboxylic acids, the thing about them is that they can do hydrogen bonding on two sides of their molecule. So you have two sides doing it and two sides doing it, and they form these things called dimers, and that keeps them together with two of those hydrogen bond interactions right there. And that means you gotta put in even more heat energy to get those things apart so you can see the high boiling point over there, okay? So they've got a lot of polarity in there, and they have special dipole-dipole bonding called hydrogen bonding going on. Okie dokie, Smokies. All right, now many of them are water soluble. They are gonna start to become water insoluble or immiscible with water when your R chain is what size, you guys? Big or small?
Big.
When you have lots of carbons over here and you have those big long chains, they'll start to become insoluble. And when you have a carboxylic acid on the end of a very large hydrocarbon chain, that's called a what acid? A fatty acid. You guys remember that? And you gather three fatty acids up and you bond them to a glycerol and you make a triglyceride. Does that sound familiar? I know most of you are sitting here when I talked about that. Okay. All right. So acidity of carboxylic acids. They are acids. Even though what we look at is their functional group and the carbonyl carbon and the carbonyl oxygen within that functional group and the carboxylate oxygen and the size of their R chain, but there is this hydrogen that likes to pop off. And if you are a molecule that has a hydrogen that will nicely pop off, you are a what? Starts with at and ends with acid. Yes, you are an acid, okay? And the acidic hydrogen or the acidic proton on a carboxylic acid is this one right here, the hydrogen that's on the carboxylate oxygen. This one will gladly pop off and become the H plus, and then a water will grab it, and then that becomes H3O plus. So you guys know that H plus and H3O plus, we use those two things interchangeably, right? And it means what?
Acid.
Acid. Okay, so this is the acidic hydrogen right there. It'll come on. Now, why your carboxylic acid will gladly let the hydrogen off is because when it does that, what it forms is a carboxylate ion right here. So this is a molecule that has a charge, so now it's an ion. And this ion right here has resonance structure. So this oxygen right here is like, oh, this feels really bad to have this negative charge all to myself. I'm feeling really negative. And the oxygen up here is like, hey, let me have a try at that. So it goes, okay, and it takes some of its electrons and flips them down to make a double bond. And the carbon right there goes, ah, I only want an octet. I can't have 10 electrons around me. So the electrons of this double bond right here flip up, and that oxygen goes from having two lone pairs to three lone pairs. So what you don't see is the lone pair electrons right there. So these flip down and these flip up, and you guys can see that happening down here, what I'm talking about. Double bond forms, carbon says, whoa! This breaks, and you get the three lone pairs up here, and that causes this guy right here to have a negative charge, and this one down here is happy. It's like, ooh, I got an octet, I'm doing what I like to do. I got two bonding pairs and two lone pairs, and this guy up here is like, oh, you tricked me into doing this, and I don't like this, so let's go back and do it the other way. And that guy says, okay, and then they take turns, and so it flips back and forth like this. And the resonance, or the distribution of that negative charge over those two oxygens, means that this ion, this acetate ion in this instance, is pretty stable. So if you're able to create something that's pretty stable, your molecule is willing to do that. So this right here is like, okay, if I give up the hydrogen, I'm still the stable thing right here, so let's go ahead and do this. So it'll give away that hydrogen. But just a little bit. So acetic acid is a weak acid, meaning it gives up its hydrogen sometimes, and other times it's like, nope, I don't feel like it. I'm just going to stay this way. All right, you guys? Okay. So the conjugate bases of our carboxylic acids, meaning these guys right here, so this is the acid, and that is the conjugate base, or the base formed when our acetate relates hydrogen, those have their own names and they have their own naming system. Aren't you guys excited to do names of these? More naming rules? Oh, you love this, don't you? Okay, so what's happening in this first reaction is the NaMOH, the sodium hydroxide, that's a base. And in water, they split up into Na plus and OH minus. So that NaOH, it doesn't stay together, it comes apart into Na plus and OH minus. And the OH minus has three lone pairs on it, and it reaches over and it says, come here, hydrogen. And the hydrogen's like, hee hee, okay. And the carboxylic acid's like, all right, I am an acid, so when I get together with a base, I have to behave like an acid and give away my hydrogen. And when you get H bonding to OH, you get a what, you guys? You get an H2O, which is right here. You get an HOH. You guys right with that? Kind of, sort of, maybe? No answer. Okay, so what's left is this right here, but it has a charge on it, so that's right there. And then, oh my. There we go. Okay. And the sodium that was sitting around with nothing to do looks over and sees what's left of the acid when it doesn't have its hydrogen anymore and notices that now it's negatively charged, so it's the conjugate base, and it's attracted to it because the sodium is positively charged. So we see that the sodium goes over there and sits right next to that anion right there. Okay. Now, in 2A, what we always did was we put the cation first and we put the anion second. So if we were looking at sodium hydroxide, that means Na plus and OH minus are sitting next to each other. But when we draw the formula, we take the charges out and just draw NaOH. Also, if we did KCl like that, we have to know that that was K plus and Cl minus, but when we drew the formula, we left the charges out. And what you guys will notice is that we always put the cation first, and then we put the anion second. But the thing about organic chemistry is we're often more interested in the anion, and you'll see it coming first, and you'll see the cation second, and the charges will get left there. Sorry about that, you guys, but organic chemists are just like that. They write it like that. So if this whole big beast right here bugs you, just put your hand over it and imagine that it's a Cl minus. So it would be the same thing as like writing NaCl, but backwards and leaving the charges there. Okay, so that's a cation. ion and an anion that are sitting next to each other. But the way we name them is the same way we name these guys. So this one was potassium chloride, so we named the cation first and then the anion. Even though we see the cation second here, we still name it first. So we call this sodium, and this came from acetic acid, but now it's not acetic acid. So what we're going to do is chop the ic acid off the end and write 8. So it goes from acetic acid to acetate. Right there. Okay. Now this one right here, if you had an H right there, it would be benzoic acid. So when we take the hydrogen off of benzoic acid, it's going to have a negative charge right there. And that means the cation's going to be attracted to it. So it'll come in and it'll sit right there. Okay. And the way we would name this is like we named that one over there. We named the cation first, so we call it potassium. And remember, the cations don't change their name. Okay. So potassium, instead of benzoic acid, it's benzoate. Okie dokie, smokies. Conjugate base of our carboxylic acid, the negative charge, plus we have a cation sitting next to it. So remember, a salt, you had a positive ion and you had a negative ion, a cation and an anion. For salt, we didn't just have sodium chloride. Why are we interested in the carboxylic acid salts? Well, because we use them to clean our clothes and to cook our food. And if we're using them to clean our clothes, we call them soaps, and if we're using them, or detergents, okay? And if we're using them for foods, we usually call them emulsifiers. Now, if you have a fatty acid would have a hydrogen right there. It's a carboxylic acid with a really long R chain. Does that sound familiar, you guys? Talked about it a little bit today. And we react that fatty acid with a base. The base is going to take the hydrogen off of here and it's going to give us this anion. And then we have a cation that will sit next to it. So this is a salt, okay? And what happens with this right here is it's charged. So this end over here likes to interact with the water side. And this over here likes to interact with the fatty side of whatever it is that you're doing. So if we're trying to wash clothes, these fatty acid tails will point themselves into each other like this, and they usually surround grease or oil, which is usually where we have our dirt stuck. And the outside parts that are charged, those are attracted to the water, okay? So the water goes, hee-hee, hello, polar side over here. And these things right here are called micelles, and the water goes, wah-ha, and down the drain, and it washes away your grease and your dirt, okay? Does that make sense, you guys? Now, if you want to cook with something like this, this guy right here would still be called a micelle, but we would instead call the soap an emulsifier. And that's when we want to suspend oil droplets in a water layer. Like if you have Italian dressing and you don't have an emulsifier in there and you shake it and you go to put it on your salad, it'll separate into oil and water really quickly and you'll get like an oil slick on your salad. Has anyone done that before? No, you guys are like, no, I don't use Italian dressing. I use ranch, right? So if you put an emulsifier in there, and usually on the label it'll say eggs or it'll say lecithin, which we often get from eggs, the little micelles, they'll go ahead and they'll suspend the oil droplets in the watery layer for long enough to where you can get it onto your salad and it's not just a big oil slick. Mayonnaise uses this concept too. A lot of things in what we cook with uses this concept, okay? So we can make soaps from vegetable oils or animal fats and a strong base. So sodium hydroxide or potassium hydroxide. bunch of oxygens on it, right, you guys? And it went on through a carboxylic acid, but if you wanted to stop at the aldehyde, you would have used what?
P2C.
Okay, good. We got that one down. So primary alcohol, carboxylic acid. So the problem says, how would you prepare butanoic acid using two different methods? First of all, we got to draw butanoic acid, you guys. What is it? How many carbons?
Four.
Four. Okay. So there's three carbons, and the fourth one is going to have what on it?
OH.
So double bond O, and then what?
OH.
OH. Okay. Is everybody okay with the fact that that's butanoic acid? Yes, no, maybe so?
Yes.
Okay. So the question is, how are we going to prepare this? Well, up here it says you go ahead and you take a primary alcohol and you throw an oxidizing agent in there, and it's going to give us a carboxylic acid. So we can put an oxidizing agent right there, or we can write in potassium dichromate. Because we want two different methods, okay? So, what kind of molecule did we start with and add potassium dichromate to give butanoic acid, you guys? It's circled up there. A primary alcohol. How many carbons is it going to have?
Four.
We're not going to change the number of carbons. We're just going to change the number of carbon-oxygen linkages. So I can go ahead and write those three carbons staying exactly the same. It's the last carbon that has got something different on it. So you guys tell me what's on the end there instead of COOH. COH? Okay, well, if I put OH on the end here, you guys, then that carbon only has two single bonds. It doesn't have an octet. So what are we missing there?
Two
H's. So we can just go ahead and put CH2OH like that, right, you guys? Yes, does that work for us? Okay. So that means that in case you guys needed it to be drawn a different way, right here is where we're going to get our oxidation. So it's going to go through the aldehyde first. So we're going to go C single bond O to C double bond O, and it's going to lose one of those carbon hydrogens. And then it's going to go on to the carboxylic acid, where it goes to another, a third carbon oxygen linkage, and it loses another one of the hydrogens. Are you guys right with that? Now, if we wanted to do a second way, all we have to do is go, oh, okay. Instead of using potassium dichromate, I can use what? Sodium dichromate, right, guys? Yes, no, maybe so? What about potassium permanganate? Yep. Okay, those are both valid. We don't have to mess the structures up or anything at all. We can just switch out what we're using. Two different methods. Questions for me? Concerns? Complaints? Okay, moving on. So, oh, you guys already saw this. This is like one semester. This is the semester where I had the surgery on my nose and I was looking at my Vicks inhaler. And we had just done chapter 15 and I was looking at it and I was like, methamphetamine, oh my gosh! And I looked it up and I was like, oh, it's the enantiomer! And so I put it into this lecture because we were on this lecture when I got back. So anyways, you guys have seen this and I had put it in chapter 15 where it belongs. But there it is again! Okay, so now we're on to esters. Esters, you guys are going to see the carbonyl group again. Yay! Aren't you excited? So it's going to have an R group on one side, and instead of the OH, like a carboxylic acid, it's going to have an OR. Now the R's can be exactly the same thing, or they an example over there is methyl acetate. Now, this right here, the methyl and then the space, that's telling you about this right here. There's a methyl, and then that right there is your acetate, okay? Any questions on that, you guys? Kind of okay with this? All right. Now, our esters, they can also form cyclic structures. And down here, you guys can see that the cyclic ester is called a lactone. So it has its own special name, lactone. So around this side, you've got your R group. And around this side, you have your OR. And it just so happens that your R group and your OR are connected on the ring. And I know we all hate that, but that's the way it goes. All right? Okay, so can everybody see the ester there, even though it's in a ring? So, the one that we're going to do in lab, you guys, the common name for it is isoamyl acetate. It's also called pentyl acetate. And how we're going to form this is we're going to take an alcohol and a carboxylic acid, and we're going to use some acid, H2SO4, and we're going to form an ester. So this right here is our OR. This is our R group over here. So it's just drawing it backwards from the other side. And then you guys are going to waft the vapors towards you, and you're going to go, oh, this smells good. And then we're going to do the amines chapter, and you guys are going to be like, this smells disgusting. So that's banana oil or isoamyl acetate. This is also the alarm pheromone for bees, so you guys aren't going to want to make this in lab and slather it on you because you might get attacked, okay? We're also going to make oil of wintergreen, and this is called methyl salicylate. So what you guys will notice is that we have a carboxylic acid, and we're taking an alcohol and we're putting in an acid, which should sound familiar. That's the process of what we did to make banana oil. And we're going to make this guy over here, which is an ester. So you guys can see you've got your OR group over here. And that's the methyl part of your methyl salicylate, the methyl right here. And then the rest of this over here is your R group. Don't worry about the fact that it's that big thing right there. Okay? So here's your R group, carbonyl carbon, and then OR. Okie dokie smokies. And this came around also for you guys to smell. Questions for me? Nothing? We're good? But the bottom part says esters cannot form hydrogen bonds. So remember, you guys, hydrogen bonds were special kinds of dipole-dipole bonds that were stronger than regular dipole-dipole bonds. So they do dipole-dipole bonding, but not hydrogen bonding. So they have a lower boiling point than alcohols because no hydrogen bonding, but they have a higher boiling point than just alkanes because of the dipole-dipole. Are we okay with that, you guys? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. And this slide right here, you guys can see that for the carboxylic acids, you have a hydrogen that's bonded to a very electronegative. you have to have a hydrogen that's bonded to a very electronegative atom interacting with the lone pairs of a very electronegative atom. So because this oxygen right here is electronegative, what it does is it shifts the electrons that these guys share this way, and it makes this more partially positive than it would usually be, and more attracted to this electronegative atom's electrons right there. So you have a really good interaction between carboxylic acids, which gives the carboxylic acids a high boiling point. But with the ester, you guys can see that instead of having a hydrogen on that oxygen right there, it's bonded to a carbon. So you don't get the same kind of interactions. You don't get the hydrogen bonding. You do have polarity because oxygen and carbon have very different electronegativities, just not the special dipole-dipole one. So solubility in water. Esters can hydrogen bond with water, but they can only do so by using their oxygen. They don't have hydrogens on their oxygens double hydrogen bonding that the carboxylic acids can do. So they tend to be soluble in water when these R groups right here are small, and they tend to be insoluble in water when these R groups are very large. Now, does that make sense to us, you guys? Okay, so molecules that are about the same size that don't have the oxygens in them and don't have any polarity, those are going to be a lot less soluble in water because they're nonpolar, and water is what you guys polar. Whereas the esters are polar because of the electronegative oxygens. Okay, but again, if you have large nonpolar side chains, then it's going to become insoluble. Now, when we compare them with alcohols down here, what do you guys notice with the solubility? Do you guys notice how you can get a little more ester into water, like 33 grams of ester for 100 grams of water, and with the alcohol it's 12.5 there? That's a little bit weird, huh? Yeah, but you have two oxygens there that are doing polarity and are attracted to the water there. So that's kind of interesting. Yes, no, maybe so? Yeah? Okay. All right, so naming esters. Woohoo! More naming rules! You guys are so excited about this, right? We've already done a little bit of it. Not only in this chapter, but there's another chapter that I brought this up in. And I was like, don't worry, when we get to the next chapter, we'll do this. Okay, so what we want to do is identify the alkyl group attached to the carboxylic oxygen and name this first. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the green R over here. We're going to name that group first, and then we're going to add a space. So that R prime right there is a CH3. We would start the name out with what? Methyl, and then a space. Are we okay with that, you guys? Okay. So then we're going to identify the carboxylic acid portion of the molecule and change the ic acid ending to 8 in common naming, not name, and 08 in IUPAC naming. Okay? So if we looked at this right here, the first thing that we would identify is CH2CH3 because that's our R group over there. So when you have two carbons, that's what? Don't you?
Ethyl.
Ethyl. Okay, so we would do ethyl. And then space. Now, with common nomenclature, if you had an H right there, that would be acetic acid, okay? So what that up there said is take the ic acid ending off and just put 8. So instead of acetic acid, it would be acetate. And with IUPAC ending, what we're gonna do is the same process again. We're gonna say ethyl space. And then instead of acetic acid or acetate, because that's common nomenclature, we're going to go ahead and say this has two carbons in it. And when we have two carbons, the name's going to start with what? F, right? Or Fm, okay? So if we have this in a UPAC nomenclature, that would be, and there was an H right here, that would be ethanoic acid. So we take off the ic acid ending and put OH. So we've got ethyl ethanoate. Or you take the E off of the ethane and you add OH. You can think about it either way. Okay? So two carbons, ethane, but it's got this on it. So we take off the E and put OH. Super exciting stuff, right, guys? Yes. Okay. So, why is it all circled already and everything? Interesting. Okay, so, oh, it won't let me erase that stuff. Interesting. Okay, so when naming a parent chain that contains a ring, name the alkene and then name and then change carboxylic acid to carboxylate. So right here when we name this one, you guys, we have cyclohexane carboxylic acid. But if this is not a carboxylic acid, if it's an ester group, we have to change it up a little bit, okay? So what we do is we name the R group first of the OR. So this is a little T here, okay? So that would be T or tert-butyl. So the R part of the OR comes first, and then we do space. Okay, so naming that. And then we would name this, what it's saying down there is that we would name this like it was a carboxylic acid, except we would have carboxylate instead of carboxylic acid. So cyclohexane carboxylate. That, okay? Now it would be cyclohexane carboxylic acid if there was an H right here. All right, you guys? Okay. So at the bottom, it shows you another little example, which is really cool because I wouldn't have remembered that unless it got saved like that by some strange reason I probably didn't mean to do. But there it is. So if you had this structure right here, what we would do is we'd name this R group of the OR first, and when you have three carbons and it's connected to the center one, it's an isopropyl instead of a propyl. You guys remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that would be isopropyl and then space, and because this is a ring, you just say the ring's name, cyclopentane, and then this is not a carboxylic acid right here, like this ending right here. It's part of an ester, so you can call it carboxylate instead. This little part right here. Okay? Woohoo! Okay, so anyone want to try the first one here? Okay, the red part of the structure is telling you name that first. What is that? We should be okay with that part. Yeah, the red part is called ethyl. Okay, so then we do space. And on this side, we've got 1, 2, 3 carbons. So when you have 3 carbons, you guys, what are you going to have in the name?
Propyl.
Yeah, you're going to have some kind of prop, like propyl or propane or propan something, right? Okay, so we said that if we were to think about it as a carboxylic acid, that would be propanoic acid right there. Or we said if we thought about it as a propane chain, we would take the E off the end and add what ending?
Carboxylic.
That was when we had a ring. So right here it says that we add OH to the end of it for IUPAC. that right with that one? Yes, don't maybe so? Okay, for the next one, most of us can figure out what we should say first, right?
Methyl.
Yeah, methyl and then space. Is everybody all right, at least to that point? I identify the R group as hanging off of my O, and then I do a space. Okay, so then I have to figure out what's after the space. And we've got one, two carbons there. And whenever we have two carbons in a diupack, there's some kind of F in the name, right, you guys? Okay, so we can do it two ways. We can say, okay, if this was an H right here, that would be ethanoic acid, and the rule say I take the ic acid off the ending and change it to OA, so that would be ethanoA. Or we can think about if it was like CH3, that would be ethane. Chop the E off the end and add OA, and it would still be ethanoA. Same thing. Okay, you guys? All right. So this is methyl ethanoA. So if you guys have ethanoic acid, you would take ic acid off the end, okay? Or oic acid off the end and make it oate. And if you're thinking about it like ethane, you take the E off the end and add oate, and you get ethanoate either way. You guys see what I mean? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. So what if we were doing common nomenclature for number two? Would the first part of it still be the same? Would we start with methyl?
Yeah.
Yes. We would still do methyl and then space. Okay? And then we have to deal with what is the common name for something that has two carbons, and one of them is a carbonyl carbon, and I'm adding something to the other side, and it was the acete thing, like acetic acid. So that would be but it's just acetate. But if we look at this slide right here, it says for common naming, there's an N right there, you have the 8 ending instead of 08. So does that explain why it's not acetoate and it's acetate? Are we okay with that? All right. So we have methyl acetate. Are we okay with that? Okay. So the next one, we've already done that on the other slide where it was already drawn in there. No one let me erase it. So tell me what you guys named first. It's the thing we always name first. Yes, the R group that is attached to the O. So maybe it wasn't what we did on the other page. So we did it the other way over here. The isopropyl group was connected to that O, and on this one, it's the cyclopentyl group that's connected to the O. Ooh, okay. So we're going to start with cyclopentyl. Yes, no, maybe so, you guys? Okay, so that is the R group over there. So it's cyclopentyl. Anyone have a problem with that? Name it just like we would name methyl or ethyl or propyl. Okay, cyclopentyl, and then what?
Two methyl.
Okay, cyclopentyl, two methyl. cyclopentyl out front into the space, that is telling our reader that that is the group that is connected to the carboxylate oxygen over here. And because we have the O8 ending, it's telling our reader we have an ester. Okay, does that make sense, you guys? Yes, no, maybe so? Okay, yay! That was a heck of a whole lot of naming for you guys today. So let's draw some stuff. So this one should be propyl, not propyl. Although propyl sounds a little more fun than propyl, right, you guys? Oh, that's so propyl. Okay, so propyl formates. What does propyl look like, you guys?
Three carbons.
Yeah, so you have three carbons. And then there's a space between that and formate. So it's telling you that propyl is connected to a what? Which atom?
The O.
The O. And then that O is connected to which?
Carbon.
A carbon. And the ending, the 8 part of it, is telling us that we've got an ester there. So that carbon must have the double bond O on it. You guys are right about that? Okay. So, form. Form is common nomenclature telling you that you have how many carbons. Think about formaldehyde or formic acid.
One.
One. Okay? If it was a UPAC, it would be meth, telling you you have one carbon. But if it's common nomenclature, form is telling you you have one. So, propyl formate. Have just that right there. And I know that's like, oh, I want another R group over there, but for me, that's all you have. You have one carbon. Okay? Is that all right with you guys? Yes, no, maybe so? Okay, we've got phenyl benzoate. So what is a phenyl? Not part of the parent chain, right, you guys?
Yeah.
When the benzene ring is parent chain, we call that benzene. But when it's some kind of branch that's not the parent chain, we call it phenyl. You guys remember that? Okay. So we're just going to go ahead and we're going to draw a benzene ring. Now, there's phenyl, and then there's a space. So that means that the phenyl is going to be connected to a what?
Mm-hmm.
Not yet. An O, okay? So this part up front is the R part of the RO or the OR on the ester. Are you guys all right with that? Okay. So we have phenyl benzoate. So we must have another benzene ring in there somewhere, right, you guys? So if you guys just went ahead and drew it on there, we might go, huh, there's something wrong with that, right? Yes, and maybe so?
The double bond O?
Yes, you have to have a carbon double bond O in there somewhere to make it an ester, right? So we can't just directly bond another benzene ring onto there. And if you guys had a benzene ring, can you go ahead and put a double bond O directly on the ring? No, because this carbon is like, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. It doesn't want to do that. So your double bond O has to be hanging off of the benzene ring somewhere, right, you guys? Yes, no, maybe so?
Yes.
Okay. Now, the carbon double bond O is always connected to the OR, right, my friends? So here we have R, O, and then we have that, and then on this other side we're going to have another R group, and it can be the same or different from the first R group. So the way we say that is we put a little prime there. Okay. Now what is on the other side of that carbonyl group, you guys? A benzene ring. benzoate. Are you guys okay with this? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay. So that's phenylbenzoate. And the next section is amides, and we are going to save that for tomorrow. Again,
are we good? Okay, well, I'll leave them up here just in case you guys are like, "Woo!"